This video was sponsored by Kenhub. More on them at the end of the video.
Hello and welcome. My name is Patrick, and in this video, I'll teach you some of my tips and tricks for remembering all of the skeletal muscles of the neck that you would see in an anatomy class. And to make this lesson more manageable for beginners, I'll present the list in smaller chunks of 4 to 8 muscles. You can find a list of those sections and timestamps in the description below. And with that out of the way, let's get into the muscles. Neck muscles pull double and even triple duty. Not only do they support movement of the cervical spine, but they also move and support all of the squishy stuff inside the neck, like the tongue, palate, and airway. So this video is organized into two halves: muscles of spinal motion, and what I'm calling the muscles of squish. The smallest, easiest to manage chunk is composed of the muscles that touch the clavicle. It includes my favorite muscle too, the sternocleidomastoid, or SCM. This one sounds complicated, but it's one of those muscles that's intuitive if you break it apart. It originates on the sternum and clavicle, hence sterno and clido, and it inserts on the mastoid process of the skull. Another muscle that inserts on the clavicle is the platysma, a muscle that looks like a big sheet that spans from the mandible, down the neck, and onto the upper chest and shoulders, which lets you do this motion. I usually try to break down the etymology of these muscles to remember them, but for this one, just saying platysma makes that muscle pop, both physically and in my memory. Now, both of these muscles are superficial and easy to see and palpate, but the last one is a bit deeper. I'm talking about the subclavius, which just means under the clavicle. This little guy helps stabilize the delicate collarbone by attaching the clavicle to the first rib. Yes, you have a couple ligaments at each end holding the clavicle in place, but a broken clavicle, which is a super common injury, is potentially life-threatening, since there's a major blood supply underneath it that can get nicked by a sharp broken bone. So the subclavius is a nice little insurance policy. On the sides of the neck, or lateral spine, we have a bunch of long muscles that work together to perform a few actions. If only one side of a lateral neck muscle contracts, they bend the neck to the side. The scalene group is this bundle here, attaching to the transverse processes of some of the cervical vertebrae and ribs 1 and 2. There are 3 of them, and they follow traditional directional term naming conventions: scalenus anterior, scalenus medius, and scalenus posterior. They get their name because they make a scalene triangle, but I personally always thought that these muscles looked more like fish gills. Fish are covered in scales, so scalenes. As we move more laterally, we find the levator scapulae, a muscle that starts here on the neck and inserts on the scapula, and as the name implies, it elevates the shoulder blade. When you look at its insertion and origin, this muscle looks like a rope that pulls up the scapula. The 4 suboccipital muscles are all under the occiput, or the back of the skull, and you'll notice that they mostly connect to the head, and because of that, they all share the Latin root capitis, meaning head. I remember this one because it's where I put my hand when I put my cap on my head. When we look at this mess of muscles, we see 2 words indicating the muscle's position: rectus and oblique. Rectus muscles are usually centered on the spine and go straight, while oblique are out on the side and pull slanted. If you feel comfortable with abdominal muscle anatomy, it translates pretty well to these muscles. So here we go. The rectus capitis posterior major originates directly on the spinous process of the 2nd cervical vertebrae. This thing is centered on the spine, so it's like as rectus can be. The rectus capitis posterior minor has the same origin, so it's centered in rectus, but it's smaller, so it's minor. That's it. So altogether, they're straight muscles that insert on the back of the head. One is big, while one is small. The others, obliquus capitis superior and obliquus capitis inferior, are more lateral than the rectus muscles. The superior muscle goes straight up and down, from the transverse process of the axis vertebrae to the skull. The inferioris is the odd one out, though. It connects the spinous process of the axis, cervical vertebrae 2, to the transverse process of the atlas, cervical vertebrae 1. So the capitis in its name doesn't tell you what it connects to, but it does tell you where it is. And in this case, it's the bottom bunk buddy to the obliquus capitis superior. So while the suboccipital muscles seem like a big mess, if you break apart the names, the muscles fall into place. Moving a little lower, the muscles of the posterior spine. We covered some of these posterior spine muscles in the back muscles video, but if you have a study unit on neck muscles, it's a good idea to review them here. The semispinalis capitis has that Latin root capitis in it, so we know it connects to the head. The semispinalis part is 2 roots put together.
Spinalis usually means that a structure is going straight down the midline of the back, and semispinalis means just to the side of the center. So semispinalis capitis, then, is a pair of muscles that runs on the side of the spine that connect to the skull. Longissimus capitis is this wide muscle that runs all the way from the upper thoracic vertebrae, dabbles down on the cervical vertebrae, then attaches to the mastoid process of the skull. When we look at the greater back muscles, we see that the longissimus is the thickest and widest of the erector spinae group, and its fibers that attach to the skull certainly keep that theme. Finally, the splenius capitis inserts on the same spot on the mastoid process. The splenius root means bandage, and this muscle looks wide and long, like someone unrolled some gauze. Coming around the vertebrae, there are four muscles on the anterior spine. Not on the throat, but literally on the front of the vertebrae, all wrapped up in connective tissue. And as you can imagine, if the posterior neck muscles helped extend the spine, then these muscles help flex the spine. Although, as we'll see, some are better at it than others. Like, the two rectus capitis muscles in this group are tiny. The rectus capitis anterior is this short guy that connects the vertebrae to the base of the skull right in front of the foramen magnum, the hole where the spinal cord exits the brain. The rectus capitis lateralis inserts on the same cervical vertebrae, C1, or the atlas, and inserts on the head. Although, as the name implies, more laterally. As far as how to remember them, we already know that capitis means that it attaches to the head, and rectus means that it's a straight muscle. And we've already seen an example with rectus capitis posterior muscles, which both originated on vertebrae and inserted on the skull. The RCA and RCL follow the same rules for rectus and capitis, then just plug and play the directional terms. The longus capitis is one of our bigger anterior spine muscles. And as the name implies, it's much longer than the other muscles around it, and it's got capitis in it, so you know it inserts on the skull. The tricky thing here is perspective. You'll usually get an anterior view of these muscles, and from here it's easy to see that they start on the spine, but it's hard to see where they connect to the skull. The anterior diagram always made it seem like they inserted somewhere on the mandible. The light bulb moment for me personally was looking at an inferior view of the skull. From this angle, you can see that the basilar part of the occipital bone extends all the way in front of the foramen magnum, and that there's plenty of area here for muscles to insert. The other big muscle is the longus colli muscle, a set of muscles that connect all the vertebrae from thoracic vertebrae 3 all the way up to the top of the cervical vertebrae. And unlike the other muscles in this group, longus colli only touches vertebrae, and colli means neck. Think about it like collar. Plus, it doesn't touch the skull, so it doesn't have capitis in its name. Taken all together, if you know your regional terms and your directional terms, you're pretty much set. As we leave the muscles of spinal movement and venture into the muscles of squish, we need to lay down some ground rules. The good news is that we can still lean on our directional and regional terms. So if you're comfortable with gross anatomy, you can suss out where these muscles run. The challenging part is visualizing the squishiness of it all. You're used to seeing muscles that connect bones through distinct, thick tendons. Like, there's no doubt that the brachialis connects the humerus to the ulna. But in this unit, you'll also see muscles attached to cartilage and other soft tissues. So we'll start off with a chunk of neck muscles that do have a bony attachment. The hyoid is this little C-shaped bone floating around your trachea. I say floating because it doesn't directly articulate with any other bones. And when learning these muscles, we break them into suprahyoid and infrahyoid muscles, or muscles above and below the hyoid, respectively. We'll start up top with the suprahyoids. First up are the digastric muscles, a pair of muscles that come down from the mastoid process of the skull, loop through a band of connective tissue, and insert on the mandible. Think of it like a pulley system that lets you open your mouth. I remember these muscles because there are two muscle bellies, and di means two. Gastric means stomach, so this muscle translates to two stomachs, or two muscle bellies. Alternatively, you can remember that this muscle helps open the mouth so that food can enter your stomach, which gets that gastric root again. Luckily, the other hyoid muscles all follow the pattern of a prefix followed by hyoid, literally showing you where it connects. Like, the stylohyoid connects the styloid process of the skull to the hyoid. The mylohyoid connects the hyoid to a part of the mandible called the mylohyoid line, and the geniohyoid attaches to a different part of the mandible called the inferior mental spine, which is right under the chin. The stylohyoid is clear enough, but to differentiate between the mylohyoid and geniohyoid, I imagine them as long facial hair. The geniohyoid comes straight down off the chin, like a goatee, while the mylohyoid extends off the side more like a mustache. So, genio, goatee, mylo, mustache. The same straightforward naming conventions stick around for the infrahyoids.
The sternohyoid is this long muscle that connects the sternum to the hyoid. Underneath it, we see a muscle connect the cartilage of the thyroid to the hyoid, so it's called the thyrohyoid. But directly below that muscle's attachment, we find the sternothyroid, which connects the sternum to the thyroid. Now, I know what you're thinking, that muscle doesn't actually connect to the hyoid, so why is it in this group?
Well, based on its position, when it contracts, it can still move the hyoid.
The last new one is the omohyoid muscle, which connects the hyoid to the shoulder of all places, which is like the last place you would expect to find a hyoid attachment. But those of you who speak Spanish probably saw this one coming. El hombro is the Spanish word for shoulder, so the name omohyoid tells us that it connects the shoulder to the hyoid. Also, I apologize for my Spanish.
Finally, the hyoglossus connects the hyoid to the tongue, or glossus. As long as you can tell where your muscle of interest attaches to, you can identify these muscles.
Next up, the soft palate. It's that chunk of tissue on the roof of your mouth just posterior to your bony, hard palate. Because it doesn't have a bony framework, it relies on connective tissue to give it shape, keep it in place, or move it while eating and drinking. Like everything in this unit, breaking down the names tells us everything we need to know.
The levator villi palatini muscle lifts the soft palate and closes the pathway between your mouth and nasal cavity, keeping you from getting food in your nose.
Looking at this muscle, it's clear that it connects the skull to the soft palate and lifts it upward, giving it the name levator palatini.
The villi translates to something like veil, like a bride's veil, giving this muscle a slightly romantic connotation, as well as making sure that you don't snort milk out of your nose.
A different muscle around there is the tensor villi palatini, which also hooks onto the soft palate, but instead of lifting it straight up, it hooks under this bone called the sphenoid bone, which changes the muscle's direction of pull, kind of like a pulley. Because these muscles are pulling horizontally, they apply tension to the palate, hence tensor. So there are two villi palatini muscles, one for lifting, one for tension. Their angle of pull and etymology give you everything you need to know.
The next one, to quote Cardi B, is that little dangly thing right in the back of the throat, the uvula. This muscle is made up of epithelium and some glands, but the muscular part of it is called the musculus uvulae. If you already know uvula, this thing is a gimme.
The next two are good practice in Latin roots. We covered this when we talked about the head muscles, but the palatoglossus connects the palate to the glossus, or tongue, and the palatopharyngeus connects the palate to the pharynx. Like with all muscles that use this naming pattern, look at which structures the muscle connects.
The next chunk include the six muscles of the pharynx, otherwise known as the throat. We can divide these muscles into the constrictors and the longitudinal muscles. The constricting muscles wrap around the throat and contract when you swallow, helping you move food down into the stomach. And since our bodies tend to squeeze things through tubes with this segmented action, you have multiple segments of constrictor muscles: the superior pharyngeal, middle pharyngeal, and inferior pharyngeal muscles. They're easy enough to remember since they're just directional terms.
On the other hand, the longitudinal muscles elevate and shorten the pharynx during speaking or swallowing. We already saw the palatopharyngeus in the last section, the one that connects the soft palate to the pharynx.
And the next one, the stylopharyngeus, has that traditional naming pattern too. It connects the styloid process on the skull to the pharynx, specifically the thyroid cartilage. We've seen the stylo prefix a few times already in the stylohyoid and styloglossus, but you probably haven't seen salpingo in salpingopharyngeus. This muscle attaches the tip of the auditory tube to the pharynx. And fun fact, you know how yawning can make you pop your ears? Well, you can thank this muscle for that. Coincidentally, that's also how I remember this muscle. I yawn out, salpingopharyngeus.
The last chunk of muscles in this neck unit includes all of the muscles that attach to the larynx, the seat of the vocal cords. And before we move on, let's clarify that the pharynx includes everything from the back of the nose and mouth and the top part of the esophagus, while the larynx is just the topmost part of the trachea, which leads to the lungs. Food goes through the pharynx, while the larynx goes to the lungs. Little bonus memory device for you.
Now, the secret to understanding the muscles of the larynx is actually learning the connective tissue of the larynx itself. Other than the hyoid bone hanging up top, all of these muscles connect pieces of cartilage together.
The big piece up top is the epiglottis that seals the larynx shut when you swallow, keeping food out of your airway. The thyroid cartilage is the big piece that you see in front-on views of the larynx, but it's actually got no posterior covering. It's like an open-back dress.
Below that, there's the cricoid cartilage, the boundary of the larynx before it transitions into the trachea. This one does wrap all the way around the larynx. But scattered throughout the larynx are a few paired pieces of cartilage. The most important for us today is the arytenoid cartilage, two little chunks of tissue around the posterior aspect of the cricoid cartilage. That's an important distinction to make, though. The cricoid wraps around the whole tube, but these little guys are just on the backside. Now that we've got that anatomy, muscles like the cricothyroid make more sense. It connects the cricoid cartilage to the thyroid cartilage and helps shape the vocal cords. The thyroarytenoid connects the thyroid cartilage on the front of the larynx to the arytenoid cartilage on the back of the larynx, cutting through the larynx so it can shape the vocal cords. Fair warning though, some textbooks include a separate layer of muscle called the vocalis, which would be like right up on the vocal cords, and have the same function as the thyroarytenoid. Now, the two pieces of arytenoid cartilage are connected by two different arytenoid muscles. The transverse arytenoid connects them in a straight line, while the oblique arytenoid muscles connect them in this cool crisscross pattern. Next, the cricoarytenoid connects those pieces of arytenoid cartilage in the back with different parts of the cricoid cartilage. So, the posterior cricoarytenoid connects them on the backside, while the lateral muscle connects them on the side. So, you can see, if you know the main pieces of larynx anatomy, then you can figure out the names with these intuitive naming conventions. Now, these are just the tricks that I personally use to remember these muscles, but if you want another great resource for learning anatomy, then you need to check out Kenhub. I use them all the time when researching and writing these videos, and for this series in particular, their written articles and atlas of muscles have been extremely helpful in refreshing my knowledge of some of those deeper, smaller muscles. They've also got an enormous library of in-depth videos about muscles, histology, vasculature, nerves, and everything else you'd need to know in anatomy class. All those beautiful illustrations that you saw in this video came from them. And in addition to their library of content, I also love Kenhub's quiz feature. They allow you to build custom quizzes with different difficulties, and they give you feedback so you can figure out where your weaknesses are. You can use most of Kenhub's features for free, but if you want full access to all of their learning content and quizzes, then go to khub.me/corporis to get 10% off your subscription. They've also got a no questions asked 7-day money back guarantee, so you can try out the premium version for 7 days, and if you don't like it, get your money back. If you want to see the next video in the muscle memorization series, then check out this playlist here. Otherwise, subscribe, leave a like on the video, have fun, be good. Thanks for watching.